Hey, wetback!
Dirty Mexican!
Go back where you came
You're
from.
You're wasting my time. Forget going to college.
Greaseball.
Speak English, Beaner.
Today we hear more and more talk like that, as Mexicans are blamed for an economic crisis they never created. Politicians say they must stop what they call the immigrant hordes from crossing the border. And they don't care if it costs children their health, their education, their hope for a life. Mexicans and Mexican Americans, many of us prefer the terms Chicana and Chicano, are not the only people who face these problems. They are one of many peoples in the United States called Latino and Latina, or as some say, Hispanic. Today, there are people from El Salvador, Guatemala, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, Puerto Rico, Cuba, and the many countries of South America. According to the official census, there were 25 million Latinos here in 1993, and we know that in reality the number is much higher. The number grew by almost 70% during the 1980s, and California is now at least 25% Latino. It's time to say, listen to our side of the story.
All Latino people have a rich history and culture, but where do you learn about them? Are we on TV?
If you can find any Latinos or Latinas there, you will find that they are usually gangsters or drug dealers.
At best, Latinos are shown to be lazy, foolish, or just plain dumb.
Hollywood movies have stereotyped Latinos for years as knife-wielding criminals and steamy señoritas, or just dismissed them as irrelevant nobodies.
Are we role models in school or heroes in history classes? No way.
We almost never learn about our history, our heroes and heroines.
All Latinas and Latinos share a history of colonization, of being invaded and violently dominated by foreigners. That story begins with the fatal arrival of Columbus in the lands we call Las Americas. We are taught that Columbus discovered this continent. But hey, how can you discover a place where 90 million human beings already live? The invaders did not see the native or indigenous people of the Americas as human beings. Within 100 years, they had caused the death of 80 million Indians. They did this with guns, horses, starvation, and diseases that they brought from Europe. In what we now call Latin America, the foreigners were the Spaniards or the Portuguese. Out of their invasions came a new people, born from the mixture of native or indigenous women, European men, and Africans brought to the Americas as slaves. This new breed was often called mestizo, meaning mixed. Perhaps the best name is what we often call ourselves, la raza, the people. Raza are mostly of indigenous origin. Scholars think that 20 million Indians lived in what is now Mexico, that about 300,000 Spaniards went there, and 250,000 Africans. Over the centuries, the indigenous influence has been strongest in Mexico and Central America. You can see that in the way raza live, eat, celebrate, and often how we look.
Of all Latinos, it is los Mexicanos who have the longest history in what's now called the United States. Almost a third of the United States used to be part of Mexico. Before that, of course, it was the land of native tribes, pueblos, and nations. Mexicano culture is everywhere. It's only the Mexican and Chicano people who are kept invisible.
That's the story we want to tell here, the story of people we call Chicanas and Chicanos. Let us tell our side of the story from the beginning.
Chicano roots go back to ancient Mexico and what is now Central America before the arrival of people from Europe. Our roots go back to the mysteries of ancient civilizations long hidden in the jungle, like the Olmeca with their great stone heads, like the Chichimeca, Tolteca, Mixteca, Azteca, Yaqui, like the Maya in the Yucatan, Chiapas, Guatemala. All those faces from the past that haunt us. The gods, like Quetzalcoatl. The great cities, like Tenochtitlan. Or the Indian societies of what is now the Southwest, like the Anasazi and the Pueblos. Those cultures were often far ahead of European civilization in art and architecture, mathematics, medicine, agriculture, astronomy, housing, libraries, and calendar making. They were not perfect societies, and some, like the late Aztecs, had very privileged upper classes. But these societies weren't organized according to the idea that each person had to fight for survival in a chaotic dog-eat-dog society. That indigenous world was smashed when Spaniards arrived in 1519. At the time, European countries like England and Holland had begun to grow rich from trading with people in Asia and Africa. They were finding new sources of wealth. A whole new economic system was emerging in Europe called capitalism. Columbus's so-called discovery of America gave Spain a chance to compete with those other countries. Above all, Spain wanted gold. When the Spaniards came, the Aztecs, led by Cuauhtémoc, fought back bravely. Aztec leaders were burned alive or hanged. To the invaders, such cruelty and exploitation seemed perfectly normal and even justifiable. Sad to say, the Catholic Church supported the invaders, although a few priests tried to help the Indians. Indigenous people were worked like slaves in the mines and workshops set up by the Spanish rulers. The native women were raped. It was a time of death and destruction, tears and terror.
Still looking for gold, Spain sent more invaders to what is now the southwest of the United States. In New Mexico, Pueblo people supported by mestizos rose up in the Great Rebellion of 1680. They drove the Spaniards out for 12 years. During the 1700s, the church set up missions in California, huge plantations that depended totally on enslaved Indian labor. In Arizona and Texas, the Spaniards met fierce resistance from the Apaches and other tribes. Then, in 1821, Mexico won its independence from Spain. Father Hidalgo launched Mexico's rebellion on September 16th, now celebrated as Mexican Independence Day. The troops in that war were mostly Indian. A favorite symbol of the struggle was the Virgen de Guadalupe, the dark-skinned Virgin Mary. La Raza could relate to her, and her image continues to be found in many of today's struggles.
All those lands in what we call the Southwest today were now under the rule of Mexico, not Spain. But a new master would soon dominate. In the newborn United States, men dreamed of expanding their country all the way to the Pacific Ocean to build trade with Asia and gain great wealth. This meant taking over Mexico. In the 1800s, an idea was invented to justify that greed. They called it manifest destiny, meaning that the United States was destined to dominate everyone in its way because of its obvious superiority. As one of the leaders, Sam Houston, said, "The Mexicans are no better than the Indians. I see no reason why we should not take their land." All these men believed in white supremacy, and some of them wanted more states with slavery. They concocted a secret plan for grabbing Mexican territory. Their first movida was against Texas, then part of Mexico. Led by President Andrew Jackson, they encouraged lots of Euro-Americans, white people, or Anglos, to settle in Texas. When enough had come, the settlers declared their independence from Mexico.
Mexico sent troops to defend its territory, and the famous Battle of the Alamo took place at San Antonio in 1836. Most U.S. history books tell you that Mexico carried out a massacre of brave white men defending the Alamo Fort, but the truth is it was a long, hard battle in which many Mexicans died. The Anglos in the Alamo were actually led by an escaped murderer, a fortune hunter, and a millionaire land dealer who may have fought for the Alamo because he had heard reports of treasure buried under it. In the next battle, the United States defeated Mexico and took over Texas. Later, it was made part of this country, the new state of Texas. But the Yankees wanted even more. When Mexico refused to sell its land, President James Polk cooked up a pretext to invade. He sent troops into an area on the border that had been claimed by Mexico. When the Mexicans fought back, Polk cried, "War! We've been invaded!" But it was just an excuse. In his diary, Polk wrote that what he really wanted was to get Mexican land. In 1847, Polk's troops marched to Mexico City, killing many civilians on the way. The invasion was so brutal that some U.S. soldiers of Irish Catholic origin deserted the army and formed a battalion to help the Mexicanos. But Mexico, a weak new country, couldn't stop the Yankee march to the halls of Montezuma, as the Marine hymn says.
From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli.
The War of 1846-48 ended with the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. That treaty gave the United States half of Mexico, which became the states of California, New Mexico, Nevada, large parts of Colorado, Arizona, and Utah, plus pieces of Wyoming, Kansas, and Oklahoma. Mexico had been bigger than the United States before the war. Now the United States was a giant, and Mexico much smaller.
In the treaty, the Yankees promised that any Mexicans who stayed would have all the rights of U.S. citizens. Their property, liberty, and religion would be respected. But those promises were broken overnight. The new rulers grabbed almost all land held by Mexicans, millions of acres, by trickery and violence. They also took over our skills, like those of the cowboy or vaquero. You can tell this from the Spanish words still used in cattle raising, like lazo, corral, rodeo. The Anglo invaders also adopted our transportation systems, like the mule train, and our architecture, like building with adobes. In fact, they would have had trouble surviving without raza and Indian know-how. Courageous Mexicans resisted the U.S. takeover with their lives. They included Tiburcio Vazquez in California, who robbed Anglo cattle owners and stagecoaches with wide support from the people until he was caught and hanged in 1875. Joaquin Murrieta fought back after being driven out of his mining claim by white miners.
A los ricos avarientos, no les quite su dinero.
Texas had guerrilla fighters like Gregorio Cortez, who was persecuted because of a deputy's mistake and finally captured.
Gregorio Cortez, con su pistola en la mano, no corran rinches cobardes con un solo mexicano. Tiró con rumbo a Laredo sin ninguna temidez. Síganme rinches cobardes, yo soy Gregorio Cortez.
In New Mexico, El Feo Baca once held off 80 white men shooting at him for 36 hours. The Anglos called these fighters bandits, but to poor Mexicanos, they were heroes. In occupied America, as it has been called, ordinary people also resisted with secret organizations like Las Gorras Blancas, with Spanish language newspapers, and with cultural traditions that gave them unity.
The invaders used force everywhere to crush any kind of resistance by women as well as men. A Mexican woman named Josefa, sometimes called Juanita, was lynched at Downeyville, California in 1851 by Anglo gold miners. Lynching Mexicans was common. It happened for most of the same reasons as the lynching of black people in the South: to keep the oppressed under control. The lynchings were a kind of terrorism to prevent people from rebelling. All through those years, the U.S. government treated Mexicans like a colonized people, without respect. We were made strangers in our own land. Mexican language, food, architecture, and music were still there, but the signs said things like, "No dogs or Mexicans allowed."
Back in Mexico itself, the people fought hard against a new invader, France. Napoleon III wanted to make Mexico a colony and sent troops. Mexicanos defeated the French on May 5, 1862, at Puebla, our Cinco de Mayo. Later, the French were able to impose Emperor Maximilian and Empress Carlota for a few years. Finally, under the leadership of President Benito Juarez, a Zapotec Indian, Mexico drove them out. But a new invader was waiting in the wings. This one came with dollars. Encouraged by President Porfirio Díaz, U.S. investors took control of Mexico's economy, its railroads, industries, much wealth. At the same time, Mexican landlords were driving peasants off the land and capitalist bosses were squeezing workers. The poor got poorer and the rich got richer. Something had to change.
Despite terrible oppression, many peasants fought back against the landlords. Workers rose up in big strikes, like the miners at Cananea near the Arizona border in 1906, and the textile workers at the Rio Blanco plant, led by Lucrecia Torres, one of many strong, brave women leaders of the workers. Massacres and other bloody repression by the Diaz government could not stop them. Finally, the hour came. Revolución, the 30-year-old Diaz dictatorship had to go. Ya basta. As the revolution deepened, you could hear cries for pan y justicia, tierra y libertad, bread and justice, land and liberty.
Grito Emiliano Zapata, quiero tierra y libertad.
The heroes of that revolution are close to Chicano hearts. We remember General Emiliano Zapata fighting in the south with thousands of peasants at his side.
Pancho Villa te llevo grabado en la mente y en el corazón. Y aunque a veces te vi derrotado por las fuerzas de Álvaro Obregón, siempre anduve como fiel soldado hasta el fin de la revolución.
We remember General Pancho Villa in the north. The best U.S. generals couldn't catch him.
We remember the women who disguised themselves as men and fought with arms. Some reached high rank, like General Carmen Robles, shown here with her staff.
Valentina, Valentina, rendido estoy a tus pies. Si me han de matar mañana, que me maten de una vez.
We remember the thousands of women with names like Valentina and Adelita who worked alongside the troops as cooks, nurses, messengers, soldaderas of many different skills. We remember the children who also fought in this long struggle.
And we remember Mexicanos living in the United States who supported the revolution, like the brothers Enrique and Ricardo Flores Magón. They had been exiled from Mexico. Ricardo organized workers in this country and edited an influential newspaper called Regeneración.
The revolution won land for some of the peasants, at least for a while. It was also a time of great suffering. 1 million civilians died in the struggle. This hardship made many Mexicanos think about moving north to the United States for work. At the time, U.S. industry was growing fast and had an urgent need for labor. So Mexicans were contracted to work in El Norte.
noche pa'l estado de Pennsylvania.
By 1920, over 400,000 had come north. Raza worked as far east as Pennsylvania in the steel mills and as far west as the farms of the Yakima Valley in Washington State.
Adios, estado de Texas, con toda tu plantación. Ya me voy pa' Pennsylvania por no piscar algodón.
Raza worked in the slaughterhouses of Chicago. Raza worked on the railroads all over the West.
Adios, Coro, West y Dallas, pueblo de mucha importancia. Ya me voy pa' Pennsylvania por no andar en la vagancia.
Above all, Raza worked in the fields, en los files. Nobody should ever forget that the food you eat comes from those fields. Chances are that any fruit or vegetable you eat has been grown by a Mexican. Mexicanos have done this work under terrible conditions. They had to use tools like the cortijo, the short-handled hoe, which kept you bent over all day long.
Up to California, from Mexico you come to the Sacramento Valley to toil in the sun. Your wife and seven children, they're working every one.
Along with Chinese, Filipino, and other workers brought here, Mexicanos built the wealth of the Southwest. It was their labor that made the owners rich. Some of those owners testified before Congress in the 1920s that Mexican labor was vital to the development of agriculture and industry, valued at $5 billion. But still they thought 2 cents an hour was a good enough wage for Mexicans and Chicanos.
You fought for union wages, and your fight has just begun. You're a proud man.
Raza workers began to revolt against their miserable wages and working conditions. Cries of huelga, strike, began to sweep the West, from Arizona to Idaho, Michigan to California. Thousands of workers walked off the job, refusing to work. Viva la huelga! In 1913, Mexicanos working at the Rockefeller mine in Ludlow, Colorado, went on strike. When the bosses took the workers' housing away, they had to move into tents. One day, Rockefeller had company guards and the state militia open fire on those tents. It was a massacre. 18 people, including 8 Chicano children, were machine gunned to death.
In 1933, the El Monte Berry strike brought together Chicano, Japanese, and Anglo workers demanding higher wages. When refused, they went out on strike. Their protest failed, but it sparked militancy elsewhere. That year, 15,000 cotton workers struck in the San Joaquin Valley of California to protest a pay rate of only 60 cents for every 100 pounds. Growers ambushed workers as they left a meeting, killing several. Then police called it a riot and arrested the workers' leaders. Strikes spread like wildfire in the 1930s. Pecan workers at 130 plants in San Antonio, Texas, walked out. They were led by Emma Tenayuca, who was barely 20 years old. The strikers did not stop, even though police attacked them with tear gas.
Then came the Depression. The U.S. economy crashed, banks closed, people couldn't find work and went hungry. The bosses wanted somebody to blame for this economic crisis.
Our unemployment problem was transferred to the United States from foreign lands. And if we had refused admission to the 16,500,000 foreign-born in our midst, there would be no serious unemployment problem to harass us.
So they scapegoated Mexican immigrants, just as they do today. The government put 500,000 so-called aliens on trains to Mexico by force. Many of them had been born in this country. Many were U.S. citizens. During all these years, Mexicanos were depicted as dumb, lazy, criminal, and sneaky. These images of Raza serve to keep people's minds chained. These images tell Mexicanos in the U.S. how to see themselves. They tell the rest of the world how to see Mexicanos and Chicanos. So, if it's a Mexican in the old days, the person is romantic and colorful. If it's a Mexican today, you see a wetback or a gangster. Whatever the stereotype, Chicanos aren't quite human, right? All this was part of being colonized by the United States. All this is part of the racism Raza has faced in the schools, hospitals, factories, courts, the whole sistema. But we weren't going to accept racism forever. Workers formed unions, communities formed mutual aid societies, professionals formed organizations like LULAC, the League of United Latin American Citizens. The Raza tradition of community resistance continued to grow all through the 1930s.
The story of Chicanos and Chicanas that we have just told you hasn't been taught in school to young Raza or anybody else. It is our American history. Students are told that American history is the Pilgrims and the Mayflower and George Washington. But what about the Native Americans whose land was stolen? What about the Mexicans who were robbed and treated like a colony? What about the enslaved Africans? What about the Chinese, the Filipinos, and other Asian and Pacific Islanders who all built this country? What about the millions of Anglo workers who have enriched men with names like Vanderbilt and Rockefeller? Today, Raza say, we demand that these other histories be recognized and taught. We demand to learn them. Thousands of junior high and high school students, as well as college students, have been making that demand. When youth, any youth, are not taught those histories, they are cheated out of a full education. They are all underprivileged.
Visions of my ancestors ending with the people here. Visions of a culture which should not be contested. Hey yo, but then it regressed into where we are now, where we're going with the plan.
Decolonize your mind and let the truth be told. Revolutionize your soul and let us not be sold. There will be no hesitation, cause my nation I defend. Aztecas on the rise, revolution till the end. After 500 years of straight up life, take note, the wise Chicana nation's on the rise.
In part one of Viva la Causa, we saw the indigenous societies of ancient Mexico and the Spanish invasion of 1519, the U.S. takeover by war of what is now the Southwest in 1848, and the resistance to it by La Raza, which continued into the early 1900s.
It was now the 1930s, and Mexican Americans, as many of us called ourselves then, faced poverty and discrimination. Yet we worked hard and thought we were good citizens. Then came World War II, and we hoped things might change. In 1941, the United States needed us to fight Germany and Japan, to fight for democracy, they said. When people saw us risking our lives for this country, surely that would bring some respect. Close to 500,000 Mexican Americans and Mexicans served in the U.S. Army and Navy. We fought in the Pacific, North Africa, Sicily, France, Germany. Many were wounded, many were killed. We received more medals of honor than any other racial or ethnic group in proportion to our numbers.
But what was happening to us at home? While Mexican Americans were dying for their country overseas, they were attacked here just for being Mexican. In Los Angeles in June 1943, Anglo sailors on leave, later joined by Marines and civilians, dragged us out of movie theaters. They dragged us off streetcars, they beat us up and tore off our clothes. They raped Raza women.
At the June 7th, your Zuzu riots began, LA. A mob of sailors, soldiers and Marines marched to the middle of town to hunt those dirty Mexican Zuzus down.
At first, the sailors picked on teenagers wearing Zoot suits. This was a style popular with Chicano youth called Pachucos and Pachucas, who formed clubs or clicas in the barrio. Pachucos had their own culture, including tattoos and ducktail hairstyles, and they were proud of it. Sometimes, the sailors didn't wait to see a Zoot suit. They just beat up any Chicano, as well as blacks and Filipinos. The police did nothing to stop them. The press encouraged the attacks by calling us hoodlums and spreading false rumors.
Thirsty for blood and hungry for sales. Your headlines scream, Mexican Zoot suit planning to attack servicemen. Be downtown between 6 and 10.
We were disrespected in many other parts of this country too, like Southern Negroes, as African American people were called then. We were not allowed to use the public swimming pool in many cities and towns. In some places, Mexican Americans and blacks could use the pool on the day it was emptied. At movie theaters, we had to sit up in the colored balcony or go on Mexican night. All that was racism, with institutions like schools, courts, and banks that prevent people of color from having an equal chance at a decent life. Racism had other victims in those years. Japanese Americans were imprisoned in concentration camps during the war and treated like enemies.
The war caused a shortage of labor in this country, so many Chicanas went to work outside the home. Also, the government imported hundreds of thousands of workers from Mexico under the Bracero program. Before the war, the U.S. had deported many thousands of our people. Now they needed us again. Because Braceros faced the usual misery of farm workers, this program was opposed by El Congreso de Pueblos de Habla Española. Started by Luisa Moreno in 1938, the Congreso fought discrimination in jobs, education, health, and culture. After the war, when our troops came back, they often found themselves mistreated. A soldier who had won the Congressional Medal of Honor could not get a cup of coffee at a restaurant in Richmond, California. Felix Longoria, a Chicano killed in the war, was denied burial in the cemetery of his Texas hometown, Three Rivers. It was for whites only. Thousands of us who had fought for democracy abroad could not find any here at home. In 1948, this kind of injustice moved Mexican-American veterans to start the GI Forum, a national organization founded by Dr. Hector Garcia, which included women as well as men. More new groups also started, trying to win first-class citizenship for Chicanos. At that time, most of them thought the best way to make it was to be like Anglos, to assimilate. Other groups were considered more working class and radical.
Then in the late 1950s, the winds of rebellion began to blow. All over the world, people struggling for justice were inspired by the birth of new African nations which had fought European colonialism. They were inspired by China's successful war for liberation, by Vietnam's struggle for independence, by the movement in Puerto Rico and the brave student protests in Mexico, by the Cubans who ended a long dictatorship in 1959. Revolution was raging around the world.
Aquí se queda la clara, entrañable transparencia de tu querida presencia, comandante Che Guevara. Ahí viene Che, Che, Che.
In the United States, we had the Black Civil Rights Movement with Martin Luther King, Fannie Lou Hamer, Malcolm X, SNCC, and others. For Chicanos, what had been a time of survival would soon become a time of uprising. We were going to demand more than being accepted by Anglo society. Our days of rage were coming.
Mexicano farm workers had long fought injustice. After all, it was our hands that planted the earth, made food grow, gave everyone sustenance. In return, we received terrible pay and inhuman working conditions, like no drinking water or bathrooms in the fields. Workers labored on the giant farms of agribusiness, making a few owners very rich. We didn't have a way to defend ourselves against the bosses. Then, in 1962, Cesar Chavez, Dolores Huerta, and others organized a union in California. When 1,300 Filipino grape workers led by Larry Itliong and Philip Veracruz went on strike, the Mexicanos joined them. Cries of huelga echoed across the fields. Deputies and goon squads violently repressed the striking workers. Almost 3,500 people were arrested. Two farm workers were killed, a young Arab named Naji Daifula and 60-year-old Juan de la Cruz. Still, that black and red flag with the eagle kept on flying at marches and nationwide boycotts of grapes and lettuce. Finally, many of the big growers signed contracts promising better working conditions. For the first time, field workers had won recognition of their union, the UFW, United Farm Workers. Agricultural workers have also won victories in the Middle West with another union, the Farm Labor Organizing Committee, FLOC, headed by Valdemar Velasquez. In Oregon, Pineros y Campesinos Unidos del Noreste forced growers to pay the minimum wage. The farm workers taught us a valuable lesson. Progress is made when people mobilize, organize, and demand change. It doesn't come from the goodwill of the government or the upper classes, but from the strength of the people, la gente.
There were struggles on other fronts, too, in the 1960s. For 100 years, Mexicanos had been fighting the Anglo land robbery that began in 1836. In New Mexico, members of the Alianza Federal de Mercedes, led by Reyes López Tijerina, demanded the return of village lands once held by their Spanish or Mexican ancestors.
En el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo, de que ellos oponen de respetar los derechos del pueblo mexicano que se queda abajo de los Estados Unidos, a su tierra, a su lengua, a su cultura, pero lo que pasa es que ellos nunca lo respetan, nunca respetan ese derecho del pueblo.
The movimiento also exploded in the cities. Most raza lived there by then instead of in rural areas. Youth started their own organizations to fight racism. Texas college students formed a group that became Mayo, Mexican American Youth Organization. In California, they set up United Mexican American Students, UMAS. Then in 1968 came the famous high school blowouts in Los Angeles. 10,000 students walked out of school to protest racist educational policies. Our dropout rate was over 50%. Sal Castro, a popular high school teacher, inspired and supported the students. He was indicted on criminal charges, while many students were beaten and arrested.
The next year, 1,500 students and barrio youth came together from many states at the first National Chicano Youth Conference held in Denver, Colorado. The walls rang with cries of Viva la Raza. Many of us now called ourselves Chicano and Chicana, a word that had once been negative, but now we used it proudly. Later, we would also say, don't call me Hispanic, because it denies our indigenous and African roots and recognizes only the European. Our slogan was, we are a bronze people. We're not ashamed. We are proud of what we are. Chale with being assimilated. Chicano power. We also said, remember, America is a continent, not just one country. The youth at the conference adopted El Plan Espiritual de Aztlán. Aztlán is the name for the original homeland of an ancient indigenous people, the Azteca. According to legend, Aztlán was what we now call the Southwest, Califas, Texas, Nuevo México, Colorado, Arizona. Many Aztecs walked all the way from Aztlán to build the great center, Tenochtitlan, now Mexico City. Then they became known as Mexica, and some people think the word Chicano comes from that name.
Chicano!
We are free and sovereign to determine those tasks which are justly called for by our house, our land, the sweat of our brows, and by our hearts. Aztlán belongs to those that plant the soil, water the fields, and gather the crops.
El Plan de Aztlán called for Chicano liberation and self-determination, although it was limited to men in many ways.
A month after the Denver conference, a new student organization emerged, MECHA, Movimiento Estudiantil Chicano de Aztlán, the Chicano Student Movement of Aztlán. Student struggles were different from place to place. In the San Francisco Bay Area, for example, Raza went on strike with African American and Asian American students in the Third World Liberation Front to win ethnic studies and open admissions. Some youth also formed militant barrio organizations like the Brown Berets in 1967, led by David Sanchez, or the Black Berets started by Richard Moore and others in New Mexico. The Berets sought to serve and protect Raza with community programs like free breakfasts for the children and by opposing police abuse. Sometimes they were inspired by the Black Panther Party and the Puerto Rican Young Lords. Officials and the police hated the Berets and killed some of them, including Antonio Cordova and Rito Canales in Albuquerque.
Just as Chicanas had often led the way in past struggles, so they did now in the Movimiento. Alicia Escalante organized for welfare rights. Francisca Flores helped organize La Comisión Femenil Mexicana to work on community issues. some Chicanas were beginning to challenge the sexism they faced, like Ana Nieto Gomez of Hijas de Cuauhtémoc. We were struggling against a system that went back centuries. Before Europeans came to conquer the Americas, the importance of women in community survival and spirituality was widely recognized, and indigenous women often had a strong voice in community affairs. But Spain and the church imposed a European form of patriarchy, meaning a system based on the man as absolute head of family and society. It made women no more than men's property, intended only to serve. Whatever respect women had before, even if it was imperfect, disappeared after the conquest. In modern times, Chicanas have usually been limited to so-called feminine roles. During the Movimiento, we provided much of the work and leadership, but this wasn't recognized.
Al hombre le toca ahora. Entiende que la mujer sabe pensar y sentir.
Slowly but surely, Chicana activists began to say, there's no raza liberation if it doesn't include women.
During the Movimiento, Raza did a lot of community organizing in the barrios. One example is a fight to have a Chicano park built in a San Diego barrio instead of another police station.
Un Chicano park under the bridge.
Or it might be a struggle for decent, low-cost housing or food stamps or a community center or to free Latino and other prisoners like the San Quentin Six and Los Siete in San Francisco and Olga Talamante. One of the biggest barrio organizations was a crusade for justice in Denver. Founded by Rodolfo Corky Gonzalez, it was set up according to the familia principle. Not just one person would join, but the whole family. The crusade had programs for all ages, with a complete school, workshops for organizers, and cultural events. It fought for justice on many fronts, like racism in schools, police abuse, and election fraud. In Seattle, Chicanos took over a big abandoned school building and created the Centro de la Raza, with Roberto Maestas as director. Católicos por la Raza, Catholics for the People, made a name with its courageous protests on church steps.
Sometimes we started our own institutions because the dominant society ignored our needs, like schools, so that Raza children could learn about their history and culture. Sometimes we started our own clinics, like the one at Tierra Maria, New Mexico, which is now more than 25 years old. We also started our own political party, La Raza Unida, believing it would do more to meet our needs than the Democrats or the Republicans. Led by Jose Angel Gutierrez, the party started in 1969 in Texas and won several local elections. Other Raza worked to register Chicano voters and to elect Chicanos to Congress, hoping that would give us a voice. In San Antonio, communities organized for public service, COPS, did much to build Chicano influence on city politics. We published 30 newspapers about our Movimiento so people could have information that was buried by the mass media.
Abolir para siempre queremos un sistema en que la explotación.
People often forget that we were active in the movement against the Vietnam War. More Chicanos were fighting and dying in that war than our share of the population. Why? And why were we killing the Vietnamese, who just wanted to stop being colonized and decide their own destiny, like us? On August 29, 1970, in Los Angeles, about 25,000 people marched in the Chicano moratorium against the war.
And the main issues that were being dealt with at the time was the enormous loss of young Chicano men in the front lines during the Vietnam War. It was also a march in solidarity with Mexicanos and other nationalities in the struggles that were happening at the time.
The people, lots of families with children, youth, out-of-town visitors, gathered peacefully in a park for the moratorium rally. Suddenly, hundreds of police swept down on us with tear gas and clubs. It was the beginning of a police riot that went on all day and left three Chicanos dead. They included Lynn Ward, a 15-year-old brown beret, Angel Diaz, and the popular Los Angeles Times journalist, Ruben Salazar, shot to death as he sat in a bar.
Hey, vatos locos, children of Aslan. Spray your metallic blood till all the walls. Calm down.
Actions like the moratorium inspired posters, plays, songs, murals, dance, poetry, so much creativity. El Teatro Campesino, headed by Luis Valdez, came out of the farm workers' movement. Our newfound Chicano pride added to the explosion of art. That tradition continues today with writers, performance artists, musicians, comedians, taggers, and painters. They include lesbian writers like Cherie Moraga and Gloria Anzaldúa, whose work has helped to challenge another form of discrimination. All the artists explore our experience and culture and experiment with new ideas. Even when the movement itself slows down, our art is there to keep it alive.
The Movimiento did win some real gains. Before, there were no federal bilingual education programs to help Spanish-speaking children learn without losing their culture. There were no Chicano studies programs. There was no affirmative action. The policy which says this society must make sure that people of color and all women have an equal chance at college or on the job. So we did not march, go to jail, and die for nothing.
Para ganar la causa. Para ganar la causa se necesita una poca de raza. Una poca de raza y otra cosita y arriba y arriba. Ay arriba y arriba y arriba iré. Yo no seré vendida. Yo no seré vendida, nunca seré, nunca seré, nunca seré.
History shows that great movements are usually followed by setbacks until people rise again. This is the story of raza as well. In agriculture, the big growers have been taking back the concessions once made to farm workers. People are getting cancer and dying from poisonous pesticides sprayed on the fields. New organizing drives have had to be launched. Cesar Chavez's lifelong commitment to La Causa has continued to inspire us even after his death in 1993. We have also seen right-wing, racist forces trying to take back the gains of our movement. They try to blame economic problems on all those immigrants, when the real problem is corporate greed that doesn't care about human need. They work to pass laws denying immigrants their human rights, like health care and education. Thousands of us protested California's Proposition 187 in 1994 and 95. Right-wingers have also launched a big attack on affirmative action. In many states, backlash forces have pushed through laws like English only to deny our culture and language. So youth have had to organize big new blowouts and other demonstrations against racism in the schools. Latinos say we must stop these attacks and move toward liberation. To do that, we need to pull together all our forces. It's not easy, but there are a lot of us. For many years, Los Angeles had more Mexicanos than any place in Mexico except the capital city. Hundreds of thousands of other raza have come to this country from Central America, the Caribbean, and South America. Sometimes we have worked together, like Mexicanos and Centroamericanos in Justice for Janitors, a brave, creative union.
But many razas say we must do even more. They say we must build a whole new movement. We need even more solidarity between different razas. more understanding of our common struggles and our differences, more alliances with Puerto Ricanos seeking independence, with Guatemaltecos fighting 40 years of brutal military oppression, more unity against the abuses of La Migra, the Immigration and Naturalization Service. Remember, we didn't cross the border crossed us.
We also need more solidarity with Native nations and peoples like the Hopi, Mohawk, Diné, as we saw when the Oglala Sioux occupied Wounded Knee in 1973.
We need more solidarity between Chicanos and African Americans, as we saw in the coalition that elected Mayor Harold Washington of Chicago. Rudy Lozano, a labor leader in Chicago's Pilsen Barrio, helped win this victory. We need more black-brown unity, as we have seen in the struggles against education cutbacks and police brutality.
We need more solidarity between Asians and raza, as we see when garment workers fight together for their rights in Texas and California.
We need more joint efforts by Chicanos and Anglos, as we have seen in the grape boycott and other farm worker campaigns, or support for the struggles in Mexico and Central America. Look at the workers at Levi Strauss in San Antonio, who formed Fuerza Unida when Levi's laid them off without warning. And the cannery workers in Watsonville, California. And the Chicanas who started new community organizations like the Mothers of East LA.
Latino youth say that instead of gang warfare, raza should unite to defeat our common enemies, poverty, ignorance, discrimination, and the whole sistema that imposes those evils. Youth today are often inspired by the indigenous vision, indigenismo, which speaks to peace, balance, and respect for all living creatures. These are the values of a growing spirituality.
So when we talk about La Causa, we are not only talking about our raza, but also the whole human raza, the human race, people of all colors. Together we can stop the backlash.
Together we can defeat those who want to hold back the future.
Together we can move toward justicia y paz.